Headline Publishing Group Limited presents Double Illusion by Barbara Nadel, read by Sean Barrett. Later, when he attempted to describe what had confronted him when he had arrived at the Shahzada Rafik Palace, Inspector Mehmet Suleyman found himself referencing two famous artists. The suspect, armed with a sword, pinwheeled between two cohorts of uniformed men, his face twisted and bloodied like a figure from a painting by Goya, he said. Embedded in a background of shiny cars, sculpted gardens, and a palace resembling a wedding cake, it was also pure Salvador Dali. What it had been, too, was a nightmare. Chapter 1. There weren't many Istanbul palaces Mehmet Suleyman didn't know. The scion of an Ottoman family related to the sultans, he was one of those who, prior to the foundation of the Republic of Turkey, would have lived in a palace. But the Shahzada Rafik, located just off the high-end shopping street of Baghdad, Janissi, wasn't familiar to him. As he approached it through huge electric gates via a manicured garden just lightly dusted with snow, he snapped on a pair of plastic gloves and asked the uniformed officer walking beside him, "What do we know?" "First report came in at 1955, said the officer, a sergeant Tashdemir. "Fifth floor apartment in the Deniz building." He pointed to his left. "Complaint basically about noise from the palace, screaming." Although extensive, the palace was hemmed in on three sides by expensive apartment blocks. This meant that a large number of homes overlooked the old building. "And then?" "Then less than 5 minutes later, we had multiple calls," Tashdemir said. "A man was running about outside the palace, attacking cars. He was covered in blood." Two marble staircases led up to the palace entrance, separated by a marble platform. Suleyman could see that a man holding a sword, his shirt and trousers soaked in what looked like blood, was running between two groups of police officers who had him effectively trapped between them. "Has he attacked any of our men?" "No, sir," Tashdemir said. "He just runs. He's covered in blood, as you can see, but whether it's his or not..." He shrugged. "I've got officers guarding all the entrances into the palace, but I wanted to wait for you before I ordered them inside." "Quite right." Suleyman looked down at his sergeant, a dark young man called Irma Mungun. "I'll attempt to talk to this man first. You, Irma, may go with Sergeant Tashdemir and prepare to enter the premises with his officers if I can't get anywhere with our agitated friend." And the man was agitated. Much of the time he screamed, bending over double as if in pain. Then every so often he would look at one of the police officers, point his sword at him and say, "You!" But he didn't follow these momentary recognitions with any sort of action. He would pin someone down with his gaze, and then, as if a spell had been broken, he'd quickly look away and scream again. Before Sergeant Tashdemir left with Umar Mungun, Suleyman asked him whether he knew the man's name. Tashdemir frowned. "Not definitively," he said, "but the owner of the palace is Ates Bocuk." Suleyman felt his face pale. "And yes," Tashdemir confirmed, "I do mean the son of Esad Bocuk." "Ikmen!" Why the woman felt the need to wave her arms in the air when she was both unusually tall and dressed up for a Spanish fiesta, ex-inspector of police Cetin Ikmen didn't know. One could probably see Gonca Suleyman from space. Not that he was particularly focused on his friend, Mehmet's wife. He was rather more concerned about how he was going to continue walking, because it hurt. It had been his daughter Çiçek's idea, the walking thing. They'd arranged to meet Mehmet, Gonca, and the latter Spanish guests at 8:30 outside the church of Saint Antoine on Istiklal Caddesi. The biggest Catholic church in Istanbul, Saint Antoine was famous for holding a multilingual mass every 24th of December to usher in Christmas in the Western Church. Orthodox Christians, like Çetin's oldest friend, the Armenian pathologist Artur Sarkisian, celebrated on the 6th of January. And while Çetin, Çiçek, Gonca and Mehmet were nominally Muslims, they had agreed to take these Spaniards to Mass because they didn't know the city, and Cetin and Gonca, at least, rather enjoyed the theatricality of Christmas Eve Mass. However, Mehmet, it seemed, was not with them. Gasping for breath, Ikmen dragged himself over to Gonca and said, "Where's the boy?" Cetin and Mehmet had worked together in the Istanbul City Police Force for decades. At the beginning of his career, Mehmet Suleyman had been Ikmen's deputy, and although he was now in his mid-50s, Ikmen still referred to him as the boy, especially when speaking to Gonca. Like Ikmen, Gonca was over a decade older than her husband. She was also a woman with a sharp sense of humour. "Working," she said. Then, looking at Ikmen properly, she added, "You look like shit." Ikmen pulled his daughter towards him. "Blame her." Çiçek Ikmen was an attractive woman in her 40s. It was never easy for her to make conversation with Gonca. The striking Roma woman had effectively stolen her boyfriend and gone on to marry him. But Çiçek smiled and said, "Dad's doctor says he needs to get fit." Gonca grinned at Ikmen. "Since when did you listen to your doctor?" "Since he told him that if he doesn't get some exercise, he will end up housebound," Çiçek said. Ikmen muttered, "Bastard." "And so," Çiçek continued, "we have just walked from Sultan Ahmet and across the Galata Bridge. We did ride the tunnel to get up here to İstiklal.
Thank God.
And now, here we are." Çiçek looked up at the New Year lights strung across İstiklal Caddesi, twinkling red, ice blue and white, and added, "So beautiful." Then suddenly realizing that the three people Gonca had been with were huddling at the entrance to the church, waiting for something to happen, Cetin and Çiçek went over to introduce themselves. It was snowing again, and the two men and one woman looked up into the dark sky with dread. The Böcek family had been associated with organized crime in Istanbul since the late 1970s. This was when Ates Böcek's grandfather, Nedim, had come with his family from the eastern city of Antakya and settled in Istanbul's Üsküdar district on the Asian side of the Bosphorus. Family legend had it that Nedim Böcek had been a famous wrestler back in Antakya who had come to the big city to seek his fortune. The reality was that he occasionally rented his muscle out to a couple of Istanbul godfathers, but basically lived off his wife's earnings. Renowned for the skills of its falcıs, or fortune-tellers, Antakya imbued these, mainly women, with a mystical quality second only to Roma. Neşe, Nedim's wife, was one such Antakya falcı, and it was she who funded the property speculations of her eldest son, Esat. Neşe had always been and remained the power behind the Böcek family's brutal throne on the Asian side of the Bosphorus. Mehmet Suleyman approached Neşe's grandson with his hands held out to his sides. Ateş was, he had learned, just 21. And like a child, he giggled when he saw the older man make this peculiar gesture.
"I'm unarmed and want only to talk to you," Suleyman said as he reached the top step of the left-hand staircase.
Ateş Böcek, if this ragged, blood-soaked entity was he, laughed again for a few seconds, and then became still. Looking past the four officers who stood between him and Suleyman, he said,
"I know who you are. I see you."
"Are you hurt?" Suleyman asked.
"Hurt?"
"Yes, you have a lot of blood on your clothing and your face."
Ateş looked down at himself. He wobbled a little, and Suleyman wondered whether he was drunk or under the influence of drugs. The sword in his hand, a traditional Turkish weapon called a yatagan, clattered to the ground, quickly followed by the young man's unconscious body. Gonca pointed to the younger of the two men and said,
"He is Señor Tomas."
The Spaniard, unsure about what to do, bowed slightly when Ikmen bowed to him.
"The young lady is Señora Lola, and this..." She took the arm of the elderly man standing between Lola and Tomas. "This is Señor Juan. He is the most famous Roma in Spain."
And, Ikmen mused to himself, he was once your lover. But he didn't say anything. Just before she'd seduced Mehmet Suleyman, and then been his on-and-off mistress for the next 20 years, Gonja had taken a Spanish Roma lover called Juan. And while Cetin Ikmen had never known him, he recognized that this old man was one and the same person. Juan Cortez had, it was said, bewitched her with his flamenco singing, his dancing, and his sexual technique for one hot, crazy month back in the dying days of the 20th century. Juan had clearly continued to attract beautiful young women, judging by his nubile wife. Gonja pushed Cicek towards the small group and said, "Well, do it then." Cicek Ikmen, an ex-Turkish Airlines flight attendant, could speak Spanish. It was in reality the only reason she had agreed to come to the church. It was cold and dark, and she really hadn't wanted to see Mehmet so soon after his marriage. She had loved him, but he had always been unfaithful to her, mainly with Gonja, something she still found hard to forgive. But she'd come along anyway, as a favour to her father. Addressing the younger man, she said, "Good evening. My name is Cicek." Thomas was small and slim, with a dazzling smile. He said, "You are the friend who speaks Spanish?" "Yes," she smiled back. The older man introduced himself and the woman. "I am Juan, and this is my wife, Lola. Pleased to meet you." Ikmen, watching this exchange, wondered whether Cicek would find out any more about these people. Gonja had told him that they had come to perform flamenco as part of a huge entertainment designed to celebrate the birthday of the local Roma godfather, Şevket Sesler, on the 26th of December. A bully, a crook, and possibly even a murderer, Sesler ran the Roma section of the nearby district of Talabasha. Gonja, though an artist by profession, made sure that he left her and her family alone by regularly reading his cards. A policeman husband was aware of this connection, even though Ikmen knew he didn't like it. Sesler was a fact of life for Istanbul's Roma, and keeping him happy whilst distancing oneself from his activities was a dangerous balancing act. One of the priests from the church opened the huge front doors, and Gonja and her party, together with a large group of other worshippers, piled inside. The palace's great central staircase was a mirror image of the one leading up to the main entrance. Two great curving marble structures rose to the first floor, and what looked from the ground like a vast, door-encrusted landing. Ates Bocuk, or whoever the man was now receiving treatment from a doctor who had been called after his collapse. Bloody footprints descending the right-hand staircase seemed to suggest that he had been upstairs at some point. And because there were no ascending footprints on either staircase, it would appear that he had hurt either himself or someone else, or found someone in distress on the first floor. Suleyman and Ömer Mongun slipped plastic covers over their shoes and walked up the left-hand staircase. When they arrived at the landing, it was easy to see from which of the many doors arranged around the four sides the man downstairs had come. Straight in front of them, it was the second door to the right, and it was open. The two men approached. There was a large pool of blood at the threshold, and the air smelt sharp and metallic. Ömer looked at his boss and said, "There's a lot." His voice trailed away. The room was unlit, and so it was impossible to see what lay beyond the blood pool. Suleyman took his phone out of his pocket and switched on the torch function. He shone it inside, and both men regarded what they thought at first might be a storage room of some sort, maybe for bedding, because bedding, it seemed, was flung around everywhere. Sheets and duvet covers were on the floor, stacked up against cupboards, and even on the huge bed in the middle of the room. It was Ömer who noticed something else, although later on he wouldn't be able to say exactly what. Maybe it was a movement. As the beam from Suleyman's torch began to travel away from the bed, the younger man said, "Sir, pack a bit." Suleyman obliged, and it was then, amid the white sheets, the satin, the lace, and the overwhelming, dripping blood, that Ömer Mongun managed to make out a hand. Saint Antoine's high, vaulted interior was awash with light, and not just from its considerable number of electric lamps. Candles burned everywhere, in wall niches, at the base of statues, and in the hands of choristers and worshippers. Cetin Ikmen stood in front of the statue of St. Anthony and wondered whether the saint, known for his ability to help people find lost things, could help him recover his fitness. He knew it was his own fault. 50 years of heavy smoking, drinking, and ignoring the benefits of a good diet had finally rendered him the type of person doctors bothered. And Dr. Eyubulu was a constant thorn in his side. According to him, Ikmen had to give up drinking and smoking immediately and follow the diet sheet he had thrust into his hands. Now Çiçek, who did most of the cooking in the Ikmen apartment, was presenting him and his horrified cousin Samsun with low-carbohydrate meals. This meant no rice, pasta or potatoes, which were his favourite things. Not that weight was his issue, at least not a surfeit of it. Ikmen had always been and remained underweight. No, this was all about getting healthier, and he hated it. He'd already cut down to a mere 20 cigarettes a day. What more did the damn doctor want? Çetin Bey. The hand landed on his shoulder, and he looked around to see his friend Bishop Montoya at his elbow. Your Excellency. The two men embraced. Bishop Juan Maria Montoya was the Catholic Bishop of Turkey and a friend of both Ikmen and Suleyman. He had assisted them considerably during the course of Ikmen's last criminal case before he retired. Mexican by birth, he was a tall, slim, and striking man in his 60s. He was also, Ikmen knew, very knowledgeable, with a wide range of interests. Oddly, given where they were, he was not wearing his ecclesiastical robes. Like you, I am a congregant this evening, he said, as though he had read Ikmen's mind. Father Demosto will say mass tonight. But what are you doing here? I suppose a moment of religious enlightenment? Ikmen laughed. I fear not. My door is always open, Çetin Bey. I know, and I appreciate it, Ikmen said. No, I'm here with Mehmet Bey's wife, who's entertaining some friends from Spain. She thought it would be nice to bring them to mass. Çiçek has come to act as translator, as they speak no Turkish. The bishop spotted Çiçek with Gonca and the Spanish Roma. He waved, and she smiled and waved back. I didn't know that Çiçek Hanım could speak Spanish, he said. Oh, yes. And Gonca Hanım's guests, I take it they are Roma? They are, Ikmen nodded. Well, why don't you come to my apartment after mass for a glass or two of the excellent mezcal my brother sent me for Christmas? The bishop said, Spaniards and Mexicans have many Christmas customs in common, and I have a piñata waiting up there too. A piñata? It's a custom of Christmas Eve. All the children of the household must hit a papier-mâché model in the shape of a donkey or a star or something until it bursts open and sweets fall out on the floor. I should love to share my piñata with you and your daughter and friends. He smiled. It will also save me from the sin of gluttony. Normally, Mehmet Suleyman would take a dim view of fellow police officers who were unable to control either their emotions or their physical responses to stressful situations. But in the case of what was found on the bed in the Shahzada Rafik Palace, he made an exception. When Irma Mungun had put the light on in that room, he had almost thrown up himself. Irma had, plus the two uniformed officers who had followed them in. To his credit, the sergeant had quickly regained his composure, but he was still shaking. Suleyman could see his hands trembling as one of the uniforms brought him some tea in a paper cup. Nobody had been left with that ghastly mess. Just one uniform stationed outside the open door. All the other officers were in the garden, waiting. Suleyman himself had put the call through to police pathologist Dr. Artur Sarkisian. Due to increasing nervousness amid Istanbul's burgeoning traffic nightmare, the doctor had a driver when he was on duty these days. A vaguely unhinged man in his 40s, the driver, Devlet, tended to handle the pathologist's huge black Mercedes like a Formula One car. They would not, Suleyman thought, be very long. In the meantime, he had to try to concentrate on anything other than what was in that room. He also had to focus on not being sick. Mezcal was an interesting drink. Pale yellow in colour, it was served neat, save for some orange and lime slices arranged on a large plate, and, the bishop told him, sprinkled with salt and chili. Dr. Eyubolu would no doubt have something to say about this combination, but Ikmen found he didn't care. It was quickly making him feel more optimistic about life. The Aztecs believed that mezcal was an elixir of the gods, the bishop said, as he refilled Ikmen's glass. It's made from the agave plant, of which we have millions in my country. But the Aztecs were very against drunkenness, and so the form in which it is served today is one that was synthesized by the Spanish conquistadors. Europeans will always drink, he smiled. Don Jahanam tells me that Mehmet Bey was meant to be with you tonight.
He's working, Ikmen said. The nature of the job is uncertainty.
He shrugged. The bishop put a hand on his shoulder. You know, the older Spanish man is famous in Mexico.
I knew he was famous in Spain, Ikmen said.
Ah, flamenco is very big in Mexico, too.
Juan Cortes has played sell-out concerts in Mexico City. The bishop lowered his voice. It is said that some years ago, he performed for Joaquin Guzman, known as El Chapo, at his mansion in Sinaloa. Apparently it was on the occasion of Guzman's birthday.
Ikmen had heard the name.
You mean the leader of the Sinaloa drug cartel?
The same. The bishop shook his head. The most destructive narco syndicate in Mexico. When El Chapo was arrested in 2014, he was supplying more cocaine into the USA than anybody else. Can you imagine the quantities?
This was a story Ikmen knew. When El Chapo had finally been arrested, there had been some in the Turkish police who had comforted themselves that such things couldn't happen in their country. But Ikmen knew they were wrong. There were currently three big crime families, all heavily involved in drugs in Istanbul. And Juan Cortes, his wife, and the boy Gonca had told him was Cortes' son, were going to play for one of them on his birthday.
Well, you just never know, do you?
Dr. Arthur Sarkisian said as he entered that awful, reeking, blood-soaked bedroom.
One moment you're drinking a very fine Merlot, and the next you're transported back to 19th-century London.
Suleyman, who was using his necktie as a makeshift face covering, said,
Meaning?
I mean, Inspector, said the pathologist, that this scene reminds me of a photograph of one of Jack the Ripper's victims. He absolutely terrorized London in the 1880s, but was never caught. His last victim was a prostitute called Mary Jane Kelly. He cut her to shreds.
At the risk of sounding ignorant, where will you start?
He looked at his watch. My assistant, Dr. Mardin, is on her way. We will decide together how best to approach this.
Then I will leave you with it, Suleyman said. As he descended the stairs and made his way back to the front entrance, the inspector yet again found himself marvelling at the way in which Dr. Sarkisian always approached his work with such calm professionalism. If asked how he could do his job day after day, year after year, he always joked that someone has to do it. But that wasn't, of course, the whole truth of the matter. He was always very respectful of those who came into his hands, and although he wasn't responsible for apprehending those who had killed them, he was passionate about doing everything he could to obtain justice for them. Suleyman knew he paid a price for his diligence. But as his friend Cetin Ikmen had always smoked his way around his feelings, Arthur Sarkisian ate his way out, and Suleyman was horrified to see how much weight he had put on since they had last met. The blood-soaked man was still lying across the entrance to the palace, but now he was awake and coughed. Emre Mungun was talking to him, but from the blank expression on the man's face it appeared that the sergeant wasn't having much success. The doctor who had attended him stood to one side. As Suleyman approached, Umar stood up and walked over to meet him. And? Suleyman asked.
He can't or won't talk, Umar said. But I've been looking Ates Bocuk up online, and this man, it seems, is him. Not that there's a lot about him, mainly pictures with his daddy and grandma.
Suleyman sighed. Ates Bocuk's father, Esat, ran the biggest crime family on the Asian side of the city. Assisted by his formidable mother, Nisha, he controlled the supply of drugs, female flesh, and slum property from Üsküdar to Gebze. Ates was his elder son, and therefore his heir. But Suleyman, for whom the crime families of Istanbul were of particular interest, knew they were dark, if infrequent, rumours about the boy. He was, it was said, hot-tempered, and at times out of control. But then that was a fairly standard description of most spoilt children of crime lords. Dr. Mardin, a short woman in her 40s, arrived, and after greeting her, Suleyman instructed one of the uniformed men to take her up to Dr. Sarkisian. Then he turned to Irma. "Where's the yatagan?" "Bagged up," the sergeant said. "Scene of crime are on their way." He looked back at the man, who could be Ates Bocuk, and added, "What do we do with him now, sir?" "I'll arrest him on suspicion of having unlawfully killed a person or persons unknown," Suleyman said. "I think it's going to take Sarkisian and Mardin a long time to work out just who it is on that bed upstairs. When forensics arrive, we'll have to get Bocuk transported to headquarters." He scrolled through his phone. "I'll need an initial psychiatric consult on this one." Unlike Gonca and her people, Juan Cortez and his family were travelling Roma. They were based for much of the time in the southern Spanish city of Seville, but spent 9 months of the year elsewhere in Spain and abroad. While they flew to engagements outside Europe, within the continent, they used an elderly camper van. When Gonca had told her husband that these performers she was providing with shelter as a favour to Roma godfather Shifget Sisler were going to sleep in their garden, he had been horrified. "We have 4 empty bedrooms," he'd told her. "Why do they want to sleep in the garden? It's winter." Although he had been married to Gonca for only a matter of weeks, Mehmet Suleyman had been her on-and-off lover for 20 years. In that time, he had learned much about the Roma population of Istanbul, but he was very aware that he knew only what they wanted him to. The exact nature of the relationship between Gonca and Sisler was a case in point. He knew she read the gangster's cards, but what else she might do for him, he didn't know, apart from the fact that it was most definitely not sexual. It had taken Gonca's Shirokolo a long time to capture the exclusive affections of a man who was not only younger than her, but also one of the handsomest men in the city. In addition, he was a scion of an old Ottoman family, and so had class as well as good looks and fine manners. She'd said, "They're Roma, my pampered prince. They are tough. We must respect their need for freedom. They will live alongside us. That is their choice." He hadn't understood, but that was okay. As she helped them light their fire and brought water for their kettle, Gonca smiled. Doing these things reminded her of her childhood in the old Roma quarter of Sulukule, now long since demolished. Back when the community had been all together in their 500-year-old home, everyone had helped everyone else, and she'd frequently lit fires and carried water for visiting Roma. Before they had bade farewell to Ikmen and Çiçek outside Saint Antoine, she had asked the latter to tell Lola Cortez to come and get her if she needed her, no matter what the time. The pretty 18-year-old was pregnant, and Gonca, the mother of 12 children herself, was very experienced in the art of childbirth. Lola had kissed her hand in thanks. Her husband and his son by a previous marriage had turned away. Roma men always left that sort of thing to women. Once her guests had settled in for what remained of the night, Gonca went into the house and up to her bedroom. As she showered prior to getting into bed, she thought about how old Juan Cortes had become since last she saw him, when they had been lovers. He'd been ugly even then, but what had attracted her had been his artistry, the way he held himself as he danced, the songs he sang, which wrenched the heart, even if one could not understand the words. Flamenco was the most passionate magic, and, in spite of his age, Juan still had it. In bed, though, her mind began to turn towards her husband. She'd missed him at the church, and afterwards in the bishop's apartment, but she'd resisted the urge to call him. Policing was his life, and although she feared for him all the time, she would never seek to stop him doing it. In lieu of his body, she hugged one of his pillows.
and waited for the sound of the front door opening. Chapter 2. It wasn't the first time Feliz and Aida had covered for Jevies. Ever since she'd started seeing this mysterious new boyfriend of hers, she'd missed several late sessions. Rammed into close proximity with two other girls who were new, they tried to talk in whispers to each other in the tiny area outside the toilets that served as their dressing room. As well as the women, this cramped space was heaving with tattered, skimpy dance costumes, feather boas, empty raku bottles, and overflowing ashtrays. One of the new girls, a 17-year-old from Edirne, coughed on the clouds of smoke that filled the air.
"Do you know how many she had booked tonight?"
Aida asked.
"Only three," Feliz replied, "although one of those is Muharram Bey."
"Oh, God, he's disgusting," Aida said. "Just the thought of those sausage fingers down his trousers."
Feliz put a hand on her arm.
"Don't worry, I'll do him," she said.
"If you do the others." Aida kissed her.
"You are an angel."
Feliz wondered what Aida would think when she saw Chivis's other two punters. But now it was done. Lap dancers couldn't just change their minds. It wasn't in the job description. Unless, apparently, you were called Jivis and had the ear of your employer. Chefgate Bey had always favoured Jivis over the other girls. In part, it was that, like him, she was Roma, but also he genuinely seemed to like her. Whether she'd ever slept with him wasn't known, but he did protect her father's apartment building, and the two men had been seen talking. But Aida and Feliz both knew that three absences in 1 week was going to infuriate Chef Kit Sessler and would put Chevise in a precarious position with regard to her employment. Like Feliz, Chevise had been working at the Kuzla, lap dancing and strip club just off the noisy Talabasha Boulevardy, for the last 2 years. It was a rough place where fights frequently broke out and a lot of the punters were on crack cocaine. But Sessler always made sure his girls were safe. Any man caught touching one of them had his fingers broken. And that happened whether the boss was on site or not. His men were well trained. Slipping into a tight schoolgirl outfit, Feliz said,
"Do you know whether Chefkit Bey is in tonight?"
"I don't," Aida said. "But if Chivis doesn't turn up soon, I'm not going to lie for her like I did last time. I'll cover, but I won't lie to Chefkit Bey again. That's too dangerous."
Dr. Emir Doksanalti was already at police headquarters when he answered Suleiman's call. He was taking a break from the assessment he was doing on a man who had tried to set his own apartment on fire. "He's broke," he told the inspector. "Rent arrears, multiple credit card debt, child maintenance. On one level, his response is perfectly rational, but I've no idea when I'll be finished here. I'm inclined to suggest I see your suspect in the morning. Is he agitated? Do you want me to call a colleague?" "He was, but he seems to have calmed down now," Suleiman said. "When we bring him in, who knows?"
"Well, I'm about if you need help," the doctor said. "What's he charged with?"
"Murder."
"Of?"
"We're not sure yet," Suleiman replied. "Dr. Sarkisian is attempting to identify whatever is lying on a bed in this man's house, person or persons unknown." He heard the psychiatrist take a sharp intake of breath.
"Well, just make sure he's seen by a medic."
"He already has been." Suleiman said this a little stiffly. Did the psychiatrist think he didn't know what he was doing?
"Let's say 10 a.m.,
Doksanalti said after a pause during which maybe he registered that he might have caused some offence. "Yes, let's," Suleiman said. He ended the call, then turned to Irma Mungun. "I'll see you at headquarters."
"Yes, sir."
"Get him booked in, and then I think we should both go home and get some sleep. Dr. Sarkisian has a long night ahead of him, and by the morning I should like to have a notion about how many people this man may have either killed or witnessed being killed." They got into their respective cars. Uma Mungun had returned to work only the previous day. He'd taken leave to go back to his home city of Mardin in order to get married. Like his bride, Uma's family belonged to an ancient sect that worshipped a Mesopotamian snake goddess called the Shamiran. The girl, who Suleiman knew was 18, had been carefully chosen for him by his parents.
Not that Omer behaved as if he were a new husband. He told his colleagues nothing about the wedding or his wife, who had come back to Istanbul to live with him and his sister, Peri. Maybe he had discovered he didn't really like the girl. Suleyman's first marriage had been arranged for him by his mother, and that had been a disaster. As he drove away from the Shahzada Rafik Palace, he couldn't shake the conviction that Omer was rather more keen on staying at work than he was. For his part, he was aching to get home to his new wife. He was also, once again, having flashbacks to what he had seen in that blood-soaked bedroom, and it was making him nauseous. Aylin was getting drunk. Her father put a hand on her shoulder and whispered, "You're becoming loud, darling." She looked up at him and said, "I'm perfectly in control of myself." Her father sat down beside her. "I just don't want you to feel ill tomorrow, my soul." Murad Ayhan organized a Christmas party for his business associates every year on the 24th of December. A fast fashion clothing exporter, Ayhan had factories all over Anatolia, but those who bought his products were mainly Western Europeans, principally from Spain and the UK. These people were almost exclusively Christian, and so it made sense for Murad to put on a Christmas party for them at one of Istanbul's most prestigious hotels. It was good PR, and it also made him happy that everybody who attended the party would go away thinking what a generous man Murad Ayhan was. The only fly in the ointment was his daughter, who, when drunk, liked to behave like a whore around all the men. Fortunately, because she was still sitting at the dinner table, he should be able to head off too much bad behaviour before the dancing began. Aylin took a packet of cigarettes and a lighter out of her handbag and lit up. This was an old red flag she'd used since she was a teenager, smoking indoors just to piss him off. She knew that smoking was no longer allowed in enclosed indoor spaces, and Murad saw several people look at her, and not in an approving fashion. He put his hand in the pocket of his tuxedo and removed something that he then pressed against her ribs. "I think it's time for bed now, my little pigeon," he whispered as he pulled her to her feet, the small pistol in his hand just grazing the bare flesh on her back. She looked at him with such venom in her eyes, it almost took his breath away. Almost. In reality, Murad was used to this from his daughter. He it had been who had made her like this, always giving her everything she wanted, and he accepted that. But there were limits. Slipping the gun back into his pocket, he replaced it with two of his thick peasant's fingers and began to walk her out of the dining room. Only once did he catch his wife's eye. Ermak Ayhan only cared about her son, Yildirim, who sat by her side like an acolyte. A hugely fat woman in her 50s, she turned her jewel-encrusted head away when her husband and daughter passed. Even when Aylin hissed bitterly at her, "Hello, mother," Ermak did not respond. It was only when her father had managed to half-pull, half-drag her to the exit that the girl screamed out, "Look, he's got a gun! My daddy has a gun and he's going to kill me!" But although everyone looked, no one actually said anything. And even amongst the Western Europeans, conversation resumed almost immediately once Aylin and her father had gone. Most people were aware that, sadly, Murad Bey's beautiful daughter was also deeply troubled. Why? No one knew. Once alone with her father in her room, Aylin sat on the edge of her bed, waiting to see what he might do. In the past he had hit her, but this time he just stroked her hair and said, "You know, Aylin, I would give you everything, if only you would learn to behave." Cringing away from him, she said, "Why should I? Because I am your father, and I love you," he replied. He stroked her shoulder. Aylin froze. Then suddenly springing off the bed, she turned on him and shouted into his face, "You pretend you're this normal businessman, but you're not. You're lying to all those people in there, and it makes me sick. I'm not allowed a few drinks, and yet my father sells cocaine. He has people killed." He punched her in the face so hard that she tumbled backwards and hit the floor. Then she began to cry. Murad stood up and adjusted his jacket. Once he'd made eye contact with her again, he said,
You will have your breakfast here tomorrow morning. Disobey me, and you will never see our guests again. Instead, you will see Sir Darbay. Varicose veins. Cetin Ikmen had always had them, and yet looking at them now, with his trousers rolled up to his knees, they seemed to be bigger than in the past. As soon as he'd arrived home after his visit to Bishop Montoya, his cousin Samson had got to work making some sort of potion to ease his aching feet. Like Igmen's mother, Samson Bayraktar was a witch. Unlike his mother, she was a transsexual woman. What she was brewing up in the kitchen was anyone's guess. All Ikmen really wanted was a bowl of hot water in which to put his feet, but Samson was doing all sorts. Eye of toad, neck of bat.
Oh, fuck off!
He heard her yell, and then he knew that she was also being watched by that bloody djinn. Shortly before Ikmen's wife Fatma had been killed in a car accident back in 2016, the djinn had appeared in the kitchen of the Ikmen apartment. Creatures of smokeless fire, djinns were common across the Islamic world, and this one was particularly ugly and troublesome. It seemed to like the corner by the cooker, and would from time to time rear up to frighten anyone trying to cook, or in fact, do anything, in peace. It was only seen by those members of the family who had inherited the magical djinn from Ikmen's mother. He himself could see it, as could Samsun, Çiçek, and one of his sons, Bülent. A less troublesome presence was the ghost of Fatma herself, who sat quietly out on the balcony where Ikmen went to share his thoughts and troubles with her on a daily basis. The couple had been deeply in love, and Ikmen still needed her in his life, on whatever level, in order to function. Samsun entered the living room carrying a large bowl of hot water that smelt of, amongst other things, tarragon. "I nearly dropped this because of that bastard," she said as she placed the bowl down by Ikmen's feet and then gave him a towel. "I know I should be used to it after all this time, but I'm not." Ikmen lifted his feet up and then plunged them into the bowl.
"God!" he squeaked.
"Well, if it's not hot, it won't do any good," Samsun said.
"My feet are the colour of tomatoes, and your veins are like whipcords."
Samsun lit a cigarette. "I could go down to the Yenivalide Jami tomorrow."
"No,"
Ikmen, lighting a cigarette of his own, held up a hand.
"I am not applying leeches gathered by itinerant Anatolians and imprisoned in jars. I don't hold with it."
"Your wife did. Fatma did a lot of things I don't and won't do," he said. Religion had been the biggest bone of contention between them. Fatma had been pious, while Ikmen remained a lifelong atheist, albeit one with an apparent direct line to the unseen. As he gingerly wiggled his toes in the hot, pungent liquid, Samson said,
"Çiçek told me Prince Mehmet didn't show up. The Queen of the Gypsies must have been disappointed." "He had to work," Ikmen said, "and Gonca had her hands full with her guests from Spain."
"Roma?" He nodded. "Going to be part of the entertainment at Chef Gebbe's birthday party," Samson said.
"You know about it?"
"Not much." Samson worked in a gay and trans bar in Chef Getsesler's territory, Talabasha, colloquially called the Sailor's Bar. Her role was officially bartender, but she was also an agony aunt to many of the younger girls, as well as, occasionally, a bouncer. "Only," she continued, "that it's going to take place on Emin Cami Sokak."
"Whereabouts on Emin Cami Sokak?"
"The old street. Just like the old days, back when the Roma were in Sulukule. It would be one big party street."
"It's winter," Ikmen said.
"Oh, that means nothing to the Roma," Samsun said. "Emin Cami will be a drunken, feasting, dancing asylum for the whole day and night of the 26th. But much as I love a party, I will be keeping away. You know what the Roma lads are like for firing their guns in the air. And it only takes one stray bullet."
"Do the police know?" Ikmen asked.
"I don't know. Ask Mehmet Bey," she said.
Headquarters was a nightmare, as well as the usual individuals and groups lurking outside in the hope of seeing their incarcerated relatives. The main entrance was rammed with petitioners, lawyers, uniformed cops, and a smattering of what appeared to be very smartly dressed men and women. As Mehmet Suleyman looked at the latter, he realized that the smallest man in that group was crime lord Esat Birchek. The covered woman to his left was probably his mother, while the man at his right hand was celebrity lawyer Eyüp Çelik. Suleyman knew Çelik well and didn't like him. The feeling was mutual. The presence of Esat Böcek meant that the man they had brought into custody was definitely his son. Clearly the Istanbul rumour mill was in good order. When he saw Suleyman, Çelik smiled.
"Ah, Mehmet Efendi," he said, choosing as he always did to use the old Ottoman form of address.
Suleyman, who hated such anachronisms, but knew that Çelik was only using it to rile him, said, "Eyüp Bey, what brings you to our door on this freezing cold night?"
"I was called by my client, Esad Bey,"
the lawyer said as he gestured towards the diminutive crime lord.
"He is of the opinion that you have his son in custody."
Ateş Böcek had been brought around the back of the building and was being booked into the cells by Irma Mungun. Suleyman said, "A man has been arrested at an address we believe belongs to Mr. Böcek, yes."
"In connection with?"
the lawyer asked. "A serious offence," Suleyman replied. "As yet we are not in a position to go into detail, but I am sure that if and when the individual involved requires legal representation, he will ask for it."
"Yes, but," he held up his hand, "that is all for the moment. In the meantime, I would suggest that you and your client's family return to your respective homes and get some rest."
He turned and walked away. Suleyman had little experience with the Böcek family. Of course, he recognized Esat Böcek. As well as being a gangster, the man was also influential in certain charitable organizations in the city. So far, he had managed, in spite of his criminal activities being widely acknowledged, to keep away from the long arm of the law. But now that his son was in custody, how would he react? Down in the cells, Suleyman supervised the incarceration of Ateş Böcek, who seemed to have descended into some sort of catatonic state. A preliminary examination by the on-site doctor confirmed that he was physically fit, with the exception of a high pulse rate. On the basis that this could be a sign of amphetamine use, a blood sample was taken for analysis and a sedative administered. Suleyman gave instructions to the custody team to check on the prisoner every 30 minutes and call him if he started to become agitated. It was 3 o'clock in the morning by the time he and Mungun left to return home.
"Ayda!"
Felice had already left, and because neither of them had seen Şevket Sesler that evening, both the girls thought they had got away with covering for Cevi's. But now here he was, large and sweaty as life, blocking Ayda's way out of the club.
"Ah, Şevket Bey."
It had been a difficult evening. Ayda had taken part in the main strip show of the evening with the other girls, which had been okay, but her two lap dances, plus the two that had been assigned to Cevi's, had been hard work. One of her own bookings had tried to touch her, and Cevi's men had both been annoyed that she wasn't there. As a consequence, they'd been nasty to Ayda. One of them had told her she needed to lose weight, the fat pig, while the other had masturbated copiously and loudly and then called her an ugly whore. But she'd not once seen or heard anything about Şevket Bey being in attendance. Nevertheless, here he was.
"Where's Cevi's?" he asked.
Well known for getting to the point when he wanted something, Şevket Sesler evoked the kind of fear Ayda knew would not permit her to lie effectively in any way.
"I don't know," she said,
"because I got 2 complaints about her not being available for our clients tonight."
"Where is she?"
he repeated.
"I don't know, Şevket Bey."
"You covered for her," he said. "You and your friend."
"Felice," she said. "Yeah, we've no idea." One of his thick, hairy hands shot out, gripped her throat and pinned her to the wall.
Then he moved his face in close to hers. His breath smelt of rakı and tobacco. She tried to move her head away, but he wouldn't let her.
"If you know where she is, you will tell me," he said, "because I know that this is not the first time you and Felice have covered for her. And do you know how I know that?"
Shaking, she said, "No, Şevket Bey."
He increased the pressure on her throat.
"Because," he said, "I know everything that goes on in my businesses. I know every trick you whores try to play on me. I know. Think before you speak, whore," he said, "because if you disobey me, I will not hesitate to make sure you never work again." No man wants to look at a woman whose face is cut to shreds.
Ida had not been born to this kind of life. Her family were pious, middle-class people who knew little of, and indeed actively avoided, minorities like the Roma. Ida, always rebellious, had been different, more curious about people unlike her own. And when her father had told her he was going to arrange her marriage, she had run away. That had been horrible too.
Shifkit, think, girl, and tell me the truth.
He shook her. Squealing in pain, Ida knew she'd have to give in.
There's a boy she's seeing.
Who?
I don't know. I swear on the Holy Quran, I don't know her name. All I know is that she's in love, and this boy has told her he'll make her rich.
Mehmet Suleyman closed his bedroom door behind him, took his clothes off in the dark, and got into bed beside his wife. As soon as he lay down, she turned over and regarded him with wide, alert eyes.
"You're awake," he said.
She placed one of her large, tattooed hands on his naked shoulder.
"You know I can't sleep without you." She kissed his lips. "I'm always afraid in case something has happened to you." "Oh, Gonca, I'm a big boy now. I know that," she said. She wound one of her long legs around his hips. "That's why I married you." He laughed. "You're a terrible woman." "And that is why you married me," she said. "I'm terrible. I'm crazy. And I'm always hot for you, baby."
He'd responded as soon as she'd kissed him. He always wanted her, too, but his need for sex became particularly acute when he'd seen or heard of horrors in the line of duty. Gonca was a generous woman, curvy and fleshy, and when he needed to hide from the grim realities of man's inhumanity to man, there was no better place for him to hide than in her arms. Was he using her? Did that even matter? He'd been with her on and off for 20 years, and he loved her. That she was besotted with him was deeply erotic, and there was nothing he enjoyed more than making love to her. He leaned down and took one of her nipples in his mouth. Gonca gasped appreciatively.
"Baby."
The very distinctive taste of her flesh, a mixture of anise, rose, nicotine, and frankincense, aroused him still further, and in spite of his tiredness, he knew he wouldn't be able to sleep until they'd had sex. Afterwards, as she lay in his arms, he suddenly remembered about their Spanish guests.
"Do you know whether they're warm enough?" he asked. "I mean, it's freezing tonight." "They're fine," she said. "We made a fire and they've got water. They will have gone to sleep hours ago. Oh, and Lola, that's Juan's wife, is pregnant. I am so happy for them."
He sighed. "Pregnant? And sleeping outdoors on the ground."
"Darling, I had my first baby on the floor of my father's kitchen."
"Yes, but you weren't thousands of kilometers from home." She kissed him. "She's a strong 18-year-old.
This gets worse. And if she's in any difficulty, I will help her." "Gonca."
She kissed him again.
"You worry too much, Shehzada Mehmet," she said. "Anyway, you must get to sleep now. I don't know what has happened, and I know better than to ask you, but what I do know is that you will need your strength tomorrow. Sleep, angel."
But he didn't. For a short time, he had managed to lose himself in her body and her love. But now that it was over, whatever had been on the bed in that old palace was manifesting in his brain again, and he had to fight not to let the nausea overwhelm him.
Chapter 3.
Numan Bey was the last traditional Turshu Suyu man to still wander the Eminönü docks. Back in the day, almost all the vendors like him had been mobile, plying their trade in cucumber and cabbage-infused pickle juice up and down the dockside, selling small glasses of the well-known hangover cure to those either boarding or leaving the ubiquitous Bosphorus feathers. Pushing a large juice container on a handcart, the small glasses rattling against each other as he moved, Numan Bey knew he couldn't compete with the places where fez-wearing, fancy waistcoat-sporting competitors sold the stuff mainly to curious tourists. but he liked his job, even if it made him very little money. And in recent weeks, it had also allowed him to meet up with an old friend every morning. Ex-inspector of police, Cetin Ikmen, had been put on a strict regime by his doctor. Apparently, if he didn't get more exercise, eat more fruit and vegetables, and give up smoking and drinking, he was at risk of developing major health problems. His daughter, Çiçek, enforced all the doctor's recommendations, with the exception of the not drinking and smoking, which Ikmen flatly refused to accept. Consequently, Ikmen now walked down from Sultan Ahmet to Eminönü every morning, and then, after a short rest, walked back up the hill again. He hated it, especially on this particular morning after a whole night of wandering about with Çiçek, Gonca, and her Spanish Roma friends. As was his custom, Numan Bey took a small plastic stool off his cart and put it down by the dockside when he saw Ikmen approach.
"Cetin Bey," he said, as he poured him a glass of turşu suyu. "Come, sit, drink. You look exhausted."
Ikmen took the small glass from the old man and sat down on the stool. Although it was only 7 a.m., ferries were already filling up with people commuting to work, going to school, or heading to the shops. Men, women, and children threw themselves onto departing ferries at the last minute, many holding large bundles, children, and sometimes pets. Even now, with three bridges across the Bosphorus, which separated Europe and Asia, thousands still preferred to travel by ferry, avoiding as it did the huge traffic jams on the roads. Once he had recovered his breath, Ikmen told Numan Bey about his visit to Saint Antoine the previous night.
"My daughter has turned into a fanatic," he said. "I mean, it was late. We could have driven to Biolu. I would have done it myself. But Çiçek Hanum would have her way. And in the snow. I mean, where's the sense?"
Numan Bey, who at 85 was over 20 years Ikmen senior, shook his head. The snow had stopped in the early hours of the morning, but it was still iron cold, and there was a thick layer of slush on the pavements. Ikmen had been lucky he hadn't slipped on his way down to the docks. Walking through Sirkeci, where the trams sometimes forced people to press themselves against the buildings to avoid being splashed, was particularly hazardous.
"But she loves you, Cetin Bey," the old man said. "It is a wonderful thing for a man to have a daughter who really cares for him."
Ikmen shrugged. He knew that Çiçek was doing the right thing by him, but he still resented her for it. He drank his turşu suyu down in one, and Numan Bey refilled his glass.
"And what of the Queen of the Gypsies and her friends?" the vendor asked. "Did they enjoy Saint Antoine?"
"I don't know whether Gonca knew what was going on any more than I did," Ikmen said. "But the Spaniards seemed to cross themselves and get down on their knees in all the right places. It was also nice that Bishop Montoya was present."
"Oh?"
"He's Mexican, so he could speak to them in their own language."
"Would Mehmed Efendi wasn't with you," the old man said, as a statement of fact.
"No, he wasn't," Ikmen said. "How do you know?"
Numan Bey shook his head. "A terrible incident in an old palace, I heard," he said. "Word is that Mehmed Efendi was called over the Bosphorus last night to a scene some say was like something from a horror film."
"Good morning, Dr. Sarkisian," Mehmet Suleyman said, answering his mobile phone as he climbed into his car and started the engine. "I apologize for calling you so early, Inspector," the doctor said, "but I thought you'd appreciate my preliminary findings with regard to the Shahzada Rafik Palace affair." "Indeed. Also, you must be exhausted." Suleyman knew the doctor and his assistant had worked through the small hours while he had been lying sleeplessly beside Gonca.
"I was, but I think I may have woken up again now," the Armenian said. "Though that is immaterial. Inspector, it is the opinion of both Dr. Mardin and myself that what lay on that bed was the remains of one person. I can fully appreciate that it might have looked like more. We even found pieces under the bed, plus an internal organ on a light fitting. I will not trouble you with further details at this stage."
Suleyman breathed in deeply in order to calm himself.
"Thank you,"
the doctor continued. "And the subject is female."
"Ah, so maybe a lover's..." "I think not, Inspector. This was a frenzied attack,
It may have been mounted against this woman while she slept. If the suspect you have in custody did do this, then his sanity must be called into question.
I see. Thank you, Doctor, Suleyman said.
Pleasure.
The Armenian ended the call, leaving Suleyman to ponder what he had told him on his way to headquarters. First she heard the front door slam shut, and then the sound of the girl crying again. Peri Mungun got out of bed and went to the door of the bedroom her brother shared with his new wife. She knocked.
Yeşili, she said. What's the matter?
But the girl just carried on weeping, and so Peri pushed the door open and walked in. Irma had bought a new bed and lots of cushions and fancy covers just before he had gone back to their home city of Mardin to get married. He told his sister that his bride would probably like such things. The probably, to Peri's way of thinking, simply demonstrated how little he knew about his intended. But then that wasn't completely his fault. Peri and Irma's parents had arranged this marriage. Yeşili and her family, like Irma and his, were adherents of a fast-disappearing faith devoted to a Mesopotamian snake goddess called the Shamaran. If the community wanted to live on, there were limited choices when it came to marriage. Peri went over to the bed and put her arms around her new sister-in-law. Speaking in their native Aramaic, she said,
"Oh, Yeşili, what's wrong?"
The girl didn't answer. She turned her head away. But then Peri knew full well what was wrong. It was what had been wrong ever since the couple had returned to Istanbul.
"Has my brother spoken harshly to you?" she asked.
Yeşili was small for 18, with long, dark brown hair, big grey eyes, and a body that possessed hardly any curves. Peri was not dissimilar herself, except that she was also tall and opinionated. The latter, however, had more to do with her age and experience. At 40, she had worked as a nurse in Istanbul for 15 years. She was also unmarried, and while she liked men, she also enjoyed being her own boss. Yeşili wiped her eyes.
No, he's always kind and polite to me. It's me that is wrong, not him.
You?
Clinging to Peri's arm until her knuckles went white, she said,
"I cannot please him. Whatever I do, he always looks sad, and he wants to get away all the time."
"No."
"Yes, Peri. He wants to be at work all the time. I don't know what to do. What if he divorces me?"
Peri hugged her. "Shh, shh." Yeşili began to cry again. But what could Peri say? Her 33-year-old brother had given up girls some years ago. As far as she knew, all his more recent affairs had been with women in their 40s and 50s. Women who knew what they were doing, in other words. And while Peri was certain her brother had performed his conjugal duties on the night of his wedding, she wasn't sure that anything had happened since. It didn't take a genius to work out that when Yeşili alluded to not pleasing her husband, she meant in the bedroom. In addition, Peri knew that her brother was unhappy too. Whenever he was miserable, he threw himself into his work, barely bothering to come home to sleep. Dr. Mir Doksanalti watched through the one-way mirror as Suleyman and Ömer Mungun attempted to interview Ates Bocuk. The suspect appeared to be in a state of fugue. Suleyman said, "The body of a woman was found in a bedroom in your house last night, Ates Bey. I don't know as yet whether you had a hand in her death. At the moment I am merely trying to establish her identity. Can you tell me her name?" Bocuk said nothing. The clothes he had been arrested in had been taken away for analysis and he was wearing a grey coverall. Whether it was grey because that was its colour or because it was dirty, the doctor didn't know. "The dead woman," Suleyman continued, "in all probability has a family who will be concerned for her. If you know who she is, I would urge you to tell me so that I may inform them." "Nothing." "We're not saying you killed her," Ömer Mungun said. "At the moment, we don't know what happened. But if you talk to us, perhaps we can work towards finding that out. As the inspector says, the name of the woman would be a start. And if you don't know who she is, that would help us too." A mere doxanalti could see that Ates Bocuk was very far away from what was happening in that interview room. He sat slumped in a chair, his wrists cuffed, head down, staring fixedly at the floor. The doctor would lay money. It would be hard to get so much as a reflex out of the kid. He'd shut down. But whether that was because of what he'd done, what he'd seen, or as a result of this arrest, Doxanati didn't know. And although he knew that Suleyman couldn't see him in the viewing room, he saw the inspector look towards the one-way mirror and shrug. The youngest of Gonca Suleyman's 12 children was a 21-year-old boy called Rambo. Like his many brothers and sisters, he was a smart kid. However, unlike his sister Asana, who was a lawyer, or his brother Erdem, who worked in IT, Rambo had decided to take what many considered to be a traditional mode of employment and made his living hustling on the streets of Biolu. Part tour guide, part barman, mixologist, part muscle for hire, Rambo Shirakolu was the type of handsome, confident Roma many Gako, non-gypsy young men, both resented and feared. He was also the apple of his mother's eye. When Rambo sauntered into his mother's kitchen and saw her hurriedly serving tea to her Spanish guests, he said, "What's up?" Looking flustered, she ran over to him and kissed him. "Thank God you're here, baby boy. Do you have your car?" "Yeah?" Although he often slept elsewhere in the city, mainly at the homes of his various siblings, Rambo still officially lived with his mother, even if she rarely knew when he would make his next appearance. "I need you to take me over to Talabasha," she said. "Why?" He sat down and looked at our guests with grave, unmoving eyes. "Because Chef Gitbe wants me to read his cards," Gonca said. "Wants to know that his birthday will be a happy one. He sounded as if he was in a foul temper, so I had to agree to it. What I'm supposed to do with Juan and his family while I'm out, I don't know."
"They don't speak any Turkish?" Rambo asked.
"No, of course not. And whatever Roma dialect they speak is beyond me."
"What about English?" Rambo asked.
"What about it?"
"They come from Spain, Mum. Tourists from England have been going there for years."
He turned to the younger man, Thomas, and said in English,
"Do you speak English?"
Thomas's face lit up.
"Yes," he said. "You can?"
"Some," Rambo said.
His mother butted in. "Tell him I have to go out. They can help themselves to food and put on the television. This is their home while they are in the city."
It was cold. He'd finished his third glass of Turshu Suyu, and Ikmen was looking out at the Bosphorus before the long, arduous climb back up to Sultan Ahmet and his apartment. The great waterway was a forbidding grey underneath the heavy, snow-filled sky. Ferries still ploughed their routes from Europe to Asia and vice versa, while enormous tankers brought coal and gas from the Black Sea, headed for the Sea of Marmara and beyond. As he turned his back on the water, he thought about the information Numan Bey had given him about Mehmet Suleyman. Yes, the inspector had been unable to accompany them to Saint Antoine the previous night, but was it true that he'd been attending a murder scene in an old palace on the Asian side of the city? If so, which one? Ikmen could think of only a couple off the top of his head. But then he remembered what the day was. It was Western Christmas, and Bishop Montoya had invited him to a traditional Mexican Christmas lunch at his apartment. This made going home up the hated hill a waste of time. Except that it was only 8 a.m., and the lunch didn't start until 1 p.m. Theoretically, he could go home, rest his legs, read for a few hours, and then catch the tram to Karaköy and jump the tunnel up to Biolu. But his whole being rebelled against it. So he didn't celebrate Christmas? So what? He knew a couple of Western Christians who lived in trendy Cihangir, as well as the nominally Muslim family of his one-time colleague, Inspector Kerim Gürsel, who lived in nearby Talabasha. And although Kerim would be at work, his wife Sinem, their baby daughter, and who knew what other examples of Istanbul's waif and stray population would be in their apartment? Between all of those, at least one of them would know what Mehmet Suleyman might be up to.
"Do you think we ought to go out to the family, boss?" Mamungun said to Suleyman, as they settled themselves in the viewing room and waited for Ates Bocuk and Dr. Doxanalti to arrive.
"Absolutely not," Suleyman replied. "Anyway, we've nothing to tell them, or their lawyer, not while Ates refuses to communicate."
In the interview room, two constables led Ates Bocuk in and sat him down. When the doctor arrived, he asked the officers to uncuff the suspect, which they did. Suleyman said to Ömer Mungun, "Not sure that's wise." "Why not? He's got two men in there with him." Suleyman shrugged. Dr. Doxanalte began by introducing himself and explaining why he was there. "Unlike the police officers who spoke to you, I don't want to talk about what happened last night," he said. "Rather, I'd like to talk about you. Now, I know that your name is Ates and you're 21 years old, but I don't know anything else about you, and I'd like to." Ömer Mungun rolled his eyes. "He's trying to build some kind of connection with him," Suleyman said. "Pierce the armor that surrounds this catatonia he slipped into. He's attempting to find a route in that hopefully we can take advantage of." Prior to his marriage to Gonca, Suleyman had been married to a Turco-Irish psychiatrist called Zelfa Halman, with whom he had a son. During his time with her, he had learned a lot about how psychiatrists dealt with offenders. The doctor continued, "I've seen pictures of your house, or rather, palace. Very grand. I may be wrong, but I assume your family paid for it? You're very young. Unless, of course, you're something like a digital influencer. I understand they can make millions of dollars. What do you do, Ates?" Still, the suspect failed to even look up from the floor. Dr. Nalte brought one hand down hard on the table in front of him. Ates merely twitched. Suleyman said, "Looks as if Ates Bocuk is deep inside himself, unless he's faking. That's not without precedent. But if he is faking, then he's good." "I'm a psychiatrist," Dr. Doxanalta said. "I think I always wanted to be a doctor."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.